exit. So we have multiple such rows, multiple such columns, so this is called a word line. This is called a bit line. And these are called access transistors. So the idea was that, so the way DRAM is accessed is that you first access a full row, and we have an array of sense amplifier here. So you access a full row, read out into the sense amplifiers, and then you can access the required columns. Okay? So after you send the row address, which will essentially will be decoded and will activate one of the word lines. Okay? And from then on, until you can access the column, is essentially called the row to column delay, or TRCD. And then the time to access the respective the required columns will take time TCAS, right? So that's what we mentioned. Okay. And we also said that as long as you have, so it also maintains a register here, which essentially records the currently accessed row. Right? So that's the open row. So whenever a request comes, what you do is you compare its row with the currently registered row here. If they match, then you don't really need to activate any word line. You can just directly do and do the CAS from the sense amplifier. Okay, right. So you can eliminate this particular phase. That's a row hit. That's what we mentioned last time. So so that's how you enjoy fast open row accesses to the DRAM array. The other thing that can happen is that the currently accessed row doesn't match with the current open row. Okay? In which case, what we said was that you need to close this row and open a new row, right? Okay. So what really happens is that you pre-charge these bit lines, okay, at that time. So that takes an extra time called TRP, that is row pre-charge. So the question is, why is it really needed, this pre-charge operation? Okay. So these sense amplifiers, actually what they're doing is that they're trying to, so whenever you activate a word line, the charge of the bit line is supposed to change, okay, by whatever amount. And the sense amplifier's job is to magnify that change to the right side. Okay. So the pre-charge operation, what it does is that it pre-charges all the bit lines to the midpoint of 0 and 1. So that's the stable state of the DRAM, where the DRAM is ready to be read. So that's what this pre-charge operation actually does. And then when you activate a word line, depending on the charge stored here in this particular cell, that will disturb this particular charge a little bit. Okay. Because this is a capacitance actually, which is storing the charge. It's a very small capacitance. So it will have a very small charge. So from the midpoint, the charge will charge on the bit line will either swing a little bit on the higher side or a little bit on the lower side, depending on the charge stored here. Right? Sense amplifier's job is to magnify that to the full voltage, either to 1 or to 0. Right? So that's what it is actually doing. Right? So the pre-charge operation is actually readying the DRAM array for the next row access. Right? Otherwise, you cannot really sense the voltage on the bit line. So that was about the DRAM details, how you access and what the latencies and etc. So we spent a lot of time last time discussing these things. Any question on this?
So write also happens the same way.
Yes, write also happens the same way. You force certain charge on the bit lines, and that get transferred to the capacitance here. So this is a single transistor cell. That's what I'm showing here. So there are many other architectures of DRAM. There's a three transistor cell also where you normally have separate word line for writing and reading. Okay. So, but this is normally used as the most dense design. Okay. The major architecture actually goes here, the most of the engineering. How you really design the cell so that it can retain the charge longer. Okay. Because if it can retain the charge longer, you can deal with the refresh cycle. Refreshing, as we discussed last time, essentially involves reading out each row in the sense amplifier and closing that row, essentially. So that takes time. Yes?
So why do we need to have sense amplifier? So it's because the voltage change on the bit lengths was small. And
yes, exactly. Fine.
But what if we have, so that may be because the capacitance in these cells is small.
Small, exactly.
So why can't we have larger capacity?
Yeah, so then you lose density. So last time we mentioned that for DRAM, the
yes.
primary goal is density.
Yeah.
Yeah. So how many bits can I pack in unit area?
Larger capacity.
Exactly. Yes, exactly. So we'll see one more thing when we go to SRAM, which we discussed right now actually. SRAM actually has for each column two bit lines, a pair of bit lines. One carries the actual value, other carries the inverted value. So that actually makes the sense amplification much faster. Here, it actually takes a little bit time to amplify the voltage. But DRAM is not much concerned about the latency. Density what matters. So if you make a pair of bit lines, density will even go down. Because you take away these bit lines. You cannot pack as many bits in. So. Any other question on DRAM? OK, all right. So what I'll do is I'll spend a little bit time explaining SRAM. So they look very similar in architecture. So these cells are, maybe I can draw it separately there. So this one you know, cross-coupled inverters give you 1-bit memory cell, right? That you probably have studied in some digital design course. Okay. Because that's how flip-flops are actually designed. Okay. So this is a typical SRAM cell. And then you have the access transistors and the bit lines. And the word lines. They look exactly the same. And this is replicated on this side and this side. So that's an SRAM array. And of course, you have the array of sense amplifiers. So here, you can easily argue out that one of these lines, I can, if I call x, other one will be x bar. Okay, so that's easy to argue. So here, what happens is that the precharge operation precharges both the lines to 1. They are both high voltage. Right. And then when you activate a word line, what happens is that one of them will essentially swing, right. One of the lines. And that difference is amplified by the sense amplifier. Now here, it's much faster because there is nothing much to amplify here, essentially. Okay. Sense amplifier will just read the difference and register the correct value in the row. And here also there is nothing like a CAS, normally nothing like a CAS in RAM, because what you do is you read out the entire row. For example, when you're designing a register file of, say, a 32-bit processor, you'd essentially have 32 cells. That would be one row. So you always read out the entire row. Okay. There is nothing like a column access within a row. So there is no CAS operation there. Right. So essentially here, only the precharge operation that is needed between every pair of operations. And there is no concept of row buffer or anything because there is no concept of column access. What you get out of sense amplifier is the value. And immediately you precharge the array again for the next operations. All right? And just to remind you how you multiport a RAM array, so we discussed this also last time. So these are single-ported RAM in the sense that I can access only one row at a time. If I access both the rows, the values will get garbled here on the bitline. Okay. Because this value will essentially clash and you'll get something, okay, some garbage. So if you want to make it multi-ported, you'll have to add, dual ported, you have to add one more access transistor. So you'll have a new bit line. Also on this side, you'll record that. And then a new one, all right? And we'll be there for all the rows. So now you can not only access the same row twice simultaneously, you can access two different rows also. So this will be replicated. That's an SRAM. So an SRAM is used for designing your caches, register files, any on-chip memory that you can think of. Your FIFO queues, your reorder buffer, everything. All right, so one small thing that is left, slightly connected to this, is so we talked about these set allocated caches and fully allocated TLBs, right, where you essentially need to make multiple comparisons, right? So the question that comes to mind is, let's take the TLB example. That's probably more comparable. Okay. So if you have a fully associated TLB, just to remind you what the structure was. We have a valid bit, we have a tag, and we have a page table entry, right? That's the organization of a TLB, and you have multiple such entries. Alright, okay. So what you do is, if it's a fully associative array, you'd take the virtual address, chop it into page offset and virtual page number, and you compare the virtual page number with all the tags here. Right? Okay. And the hope is that most one will match. And if one matches, the matching entry will give you the page table. Okay, right? The question is, how do you really design such an array? Okay. It is not an SRAM, clearly, because you're not really accessing one array. You're accessing, not just accessing one row, you're accessing all the rows. Okay. So how do you really do this? So these are called content addressable memory. Or CAM for short. So here what you do is, you separate the tag and the data. Okay. So data is designed as a conventional SRAM, just like that, the data array. All right. The tag is designed in a slightly different way. So tag is designed as a CAM, and what it does is, so this is a tag. Bunch of rows here, and this is the data. These are RAM. So this is less like this, and you connect these things. Okay, so what happens here is that when you get this tag, you compare all the elements here, all right? So essentially what happens is that there is a line through which you pass this particular tag, and there is a comparator in each of the cells, all right, in the CAM, in each of the rows. And this line tells me whether there is a match or not. Okay. So this will be either 0 or 1, the value on this line. Okay. And this line will be connected to the word line of the corresponding row. Okay. So any line that matches will activate the corresponding row in the data. And we'll read out the page table. Okay. For example, if the 10th row has the corresponding tag, the 10th line will go high, everything else will be low. So we'll read out the page table entry of the 10th row. This is the correct thing to do.
What's the size of CAM?
size is?
How many tags does it store? How many tags will it store?
Well, that's just decided by your TLB organization, right? Maybe 100, 200, maybe 2, 4, 8, maybe small, maybe large, right? If it is large, it's going to be bulky because each cell is pretty large. Each cell contains not only this bit, okay, it will also contain a line that will carry the external bit that it has to be compared, and there has to be a comparator also. Okay. And based on the comparison, it will give out the corresponding line out. So that's how you design this tag arrays. So you connect the word lines of the data array with the comparison. Okay, so what I'll do is I'll spend the remaining half an hour or so discussing some of the research problems in caches and memory. This will hopefully recap a bit also of what we did on the memory side. So let's start with the caches. Okay. So we talked about three main parameters in caches, right? These are ABC parameters: associativity, block size, and capacity. Right? What else is there that determines the cache performance? So there is a replacement policy, R. There is an index function, which decides which set an index. The cache could be inclusive or exclusive with respect to the next node level. And there is something called a topology, which I'll explain now. So cache can be roughly seen today as a 7-2. Okay. You have associativity, block size, capacity, a replacement policy, an index function, inclusive or exclusive, and a topology. Okay. So we know about these six things, except probably the topology. Okay. So what has happened today is that the caches have grown very large. So you will routinely find on-chip caches which exceed tens of megabytes. Right? Now, the problem is that if you design such a large SRAM array, it's going to be very slow, because you can guess why. Your bit lines are going to be long, because they'll span a very large number of... So in a cache, one set is essentially one block is essentially one row, you can think of it that. So essentially your bit line length will be roughly proportional to number of blocks in your cache. Although it's not exactly done in that way. It will be reorganized in a certain slightly different way. But that roughly holds. Which is why as your cache length gets bigger, it becomes slower. Right? Your bit line length increases, and the time to read out the value from here is directly proportional to the length, because that determines how long it will take to stabilize the data on the bit line. Okay. So today what people have done is that they have divided the cache into smaller chunks, which are called banks, just like a memory. Okay. For example, if you have an 8 megabyte cache, you probably design it as 8 banks, each of 1 megabyte size. Right. So that if you can decide what bank to access, you will get a small cache that will access just 1 megabyte size. So topology determines how you exactly lay out these 8 banks, okay, with respect to the processors on the chip. So let's take an example. Suppose we have today we have multi-core processors, right? On each chip we have multiple processors. So let's suppose we have 8 processors and an 8 megabyte cache, okay, with 8 banks. So typically the way it will be designed is that a processor will be given a 1 megabyte of cache. 1 megabyte bank. Okay. Question: how do I connect them? So you can think of it as, you know, 8 vertices on a graph. I can connect them in whatever way I want, as long as it remains a connected graph. Right? So that's your topology. So one connection, one possible connection could be a ring. Another possible connection could be a mesh. So let me see, how do I make it? Right. So that's a 2x4 mesh. Right? Maybe I'm like, it's clear here, but it actually looks like this. So what are the implications? Suppose this processor wants to access a piece of data, which is here. It will have a longer access latency, okay, compared to if it wants to access the data here. Right. So that leads to something called non-uniform access cache architecture. And you should be able to appreciate that compared to a ring, in a mesh, the access latency is actually smaller. For example, this processor, instead of going all the way here, it can actually now follow this link directly. Okay. It shortens your average hop time. So these are called actually a hop. So this one will have a switch here. So which will decide an incoming packet will go which way. It can go either to this bank, it can forward it along this direction, or it can go like this. So topology essentially decides your average access latency. That's the impact of it. So is it clear to everybody?
Is that analogous to distributed shared memory?
Yes, very much. Yes, exactly. So distributed shared memory, these are essentially a local memory of a processor. Yes, exactly. The whole problem is now brought on chip, and the only difference is that there each hop may be much more costly than the hop here. These are essentially short links. Switches are simpler and normally faster. Okay, so what are the research problems here? So we have to abstract away some of the details and extract some of the research problems here. So one of the problems that is interesting is if we fix, let's say, A, B, C, and T. Okay. So let's suppose I give you a cache and tell you that this is A, B, C, T. What is the best you can do? So then essentially our degrees of freedom are RF and I. Right? So we can decide whether the cache should be inclusive or exclusive. Okay. So we have discussed the implications of that and trade-off between inclusive and exclusive. We can design smart index functions. Okay, so what are the implications of index functions? Can anybody guess? What will it bind? Why should I at all want to spend time designing index function? Sorry?
Speed of access.
Speed of access?
Yes. Last year it is.
Can you do an example?
resolving the address. So at that time of
the address. Resolving the address. What is the implication of the index function?
Uniformly distributed across the.
What should be uniformly distributed?
The row address, whichever row we are accessing, we get an address. We decode the row from.
Row. What is it called?
Set.
Set. Okay.
Mm. we decode the set from it. Now this set should be uniformly distributed.
Sets should be uniformly distributed. What is that?
The value of the set should be.
What is uniformly distributed?
The data should be like uniformly distributed across this set.
Is it the data? What is it that is uniformly distributed? That will be very clear. I have a bunch of sets which are fixed, by the way. Number of sets is equal to, you can easily calculate, right? It is C over A times B. That is fixed. Okay? So, what is uniformly distributed? What is the range of index function?
This.
That, right? Okay, alright.
So, whatever the output we get from the index function should be uniformly distributed.
So, my domain of the index function should be uniformly distributed on the range. Right? That's what you really want. Right? The addresses should be uniformly distributed across the sets so that each set is equally balanced, the traffic to each set. Okay. So that's what the index function buys me. Okay. It balances all the sets so that whatever conflicts that will happen will be uniform across all sets. And replacement policy, as you can guess, of course, it will have huge implication on the performance of the cache. So usually, the way the replacement policies are designed or replacement algorithms are designed, there are three distinct pieces of a replacement algorithm. So R is usually decomposed as, there is an insertion algorithm, so I'll explain what that is. There is a page update algorithm. And there is a victim selection algorithm. So what is the insertion algorithm that decides when you have a new block coming into a set, what age should it get? So that's the insertion algorithm. So that means what would be its rank relative to the currently residing elements in the set. So for example, in LRU replacement policy, what you do is you give it the highest priority. So that it becomes an MRU block whenever you bring in a new block. That's the insertion algorithm. The second component is a update algorithm that says whenever you have an access to an element into this set, how are the ages of the elements of the set updated? Alright? For example, in LRU policy, the element that gets accessed will become the highest priority element, that is the MRU element, all right? And the others rank will remain essentially unchanged. So the MRU element will now be demoted by one position. Right? And the last one is victim selection, that is based on these ages currently, which one should I throw away to make room for a new block. Right? So it's possible to architect each one of these separately. You can do that. You can keep your victim selection algorithm fixed. You can keep your insertion algorithm fixed and try to tweak the ages on one axis as possible. Yeah. You can do other things also, you can do combination of these. So I really don't have time to go into details of this. There is two, 3 decades of literature here designing replacement algorithms. So if you want, I can give you some of the recent references on this. So these are pretty much the first order research problems on caches, that is architecting these three. Now of course, I mentioned here T2B constant because in this course we did not really discuss about this topology much. Okay. But that's also a very important research problem, that is how do you really lay down the bands properly so that, as you have already mentioned, that access latency gets affected. How you lay down these things. So one algorithm that people have explored is still ABCT are fixed, all right? To mitigate this problem, that is, this processor wants to access a piece of data here, it will have to traverse a long distance to get the data. Okay. So what these algorithms do is, they actually try to indirectly tweak the index function. So at runtime, what they do is they monitor the accesses to these banks from the processor. Okay. And they calculate an affinity matrix. That is, which processor is trying to access the data, which data most, right? And they try to move this data dynamically closer to the cross. So essentially, in effect, it is changing this index function. It is saying that how should this data be indexed into a cache? Okay, all right? So instead of indexing this data into this bank, you should index it into this bank, actually.
Okay.
So it implicitly changes the index function. So that's one way of mitigating this problem of uniform, non-uniform access latency. So that's about your cache performance. The other one important problem with caches is energy optimization. That is, and usually when we talk about cache energy, especially for large caches, so here essentially the problem is that as the transistors are getting smaller, they are getting leaky in the sense that even if you turn off the input voltage to a transistor, it doesn't turn off completely. So there is still a sneak path from the high supply voltage to the ground. So current continues to flow. That's called leakage current. So don't get confused. Don't confuse this with the leaking of charge in DRAM. Okay. It's not like the cells are leaking in the cache. It's not like that. It's just that there is a path from your high voltage to the low voltage that is always on. Okay. So that's the leakage current. And this is a big problem when you have large SRAM arrays. So and caches have become so large that they are the biggest consumer of leakage energy in the chip. Okay. So how do you really optimize leakage energy? So some of the common techniques that people have tried is you can, if your architecture techniques, of course, there are many circuit techniques. I won't go into that. So you have, let's say, an AOA scheduler split cache. Right? Yeah. You're running an application. So you start monitoring the hit rate of the application that is enjoying from the cache. Suppose you shut down one way. So you have a cache with A minus 1 scheduler instead of A. Does the hit rate of the application change? If the answer is no, then you have essentially saved 1 over A portion of leakage energy by shutting down one way without losing any performance. You can keep doing this. You keep on monitoring and keep on shutting down the ways of the cache. And of course, you may have to do the other way also. If you find that you're losing in performance, then you have to turn on the ways. Now the problem is that turning on actually takes time. It's not a zero time event. So you have to be very careful when shutting down the way. Because you have to remember that you cannot bring up the performance as fast as you can. So that will take some time. The second approach that people have tried is that although you have an 8 megabyte cache, it may be that you don't need the full cache at any point in time. You may need only a small portion of that. But the problem is that the way the data is mapped on your banks, it's all scattered. Okay, so some data is here, some data is here, some data is here. So some of the data, so a subset of data is always on at least one bank. So you have to keep all the banks on all the time. So what you can do is that, again, you can apply the same technique that we're talking about. You can figure out the affinity. And you can figure out what data are accessed together. So you can cluster them all in small number of banks and shut down all the remaining banks. So that will save also a lot of energy. So both of these techniques require online monitoring. And often people employ machine learning techniques to figure out what needs to be done that will have the optimal effect in the future. Okay. So that's about caches. So I'll just talk a little bit about the DRAM, although we have discussed these things a little bit. So in DRAM, there are, so in DRAM, the access latency is determined by your row hits. So that is a major research problem. That is, how do you maximize the number of row hits? So we have discussed one possibility in the class last time, that the memory controller could actually cluster requests that go to the same row. Okay. So that will make sure that you enjoy maximum number of row hits. But the problem is that this may lead to lack of fairness. Because what may happen is that you may end up giving the DRAM to one particular thread of your computation, which essentially happens to have a sequential access pattern. So it will have a lot of rows. It will all cluster the rows of that, the memory control will cluster the rows of that, cluster the accesses of that thread that go to the same row and will keep on sharing it. Other threads will keep on starving simply because they don't have enough row locality. So what you have to do is that at some point you have to break this. Okay, so there's a trade-off between fairness and throughput. Okay. This one tries to maximize your throughput, okay, but may hard fairness part of it. Okay. So you come up with a fairness metric here and try to figure out how to promote that. So essentially what I'm saying is that you just cannot keep on scheduling requests from a particular thread just because it maximizes the number of row hits. Okay. You have to cater to other threads also. And other problem is that's the perspective of memory controller. The second way of attacking this problem is that you could lay out your data in such a way that applications would access in a particular locality of the program. The data will be sequential and they will be accessed with maximum load. So here you require some help from the compiler for allocating the data. Compiler assisted data layout. Or you could try out a dynamic technique just like this. You could figure out that currently the application is trying to access data from four different rows. Okay. You could dynamically change their addresses, remap them to the operating system, and put them in a single row. That you could do it. So I'll put that also here. OS assistant. Dynamic embedding. All right. Okay, so roughly for the next 3 or 4 lectures, what we'll do is, we'll look at some of the commercial processors. We'll not look at instruction set of them. We look at the microarchitecture, that is how they actually implement the instruction set in the processor, right? So the first one is from MIPS, so it goes back to mid-90s. This was one of the first dynamic out-of-order issue superscalar disk microprocessors. So here is some information about this processor. It used 6.8 million transistors, so you should compare this number with today's high-end processors, which are routinely 1 billion, 1.5 billion, and something like that. 6.8 million transistors on a 298 millimeter square die, that's the size of the chip, on 0.35 micron CMOS. So we are today, what is this today? Anybody? Size of the smallest feature? 22 nanometer. Yes, so that's in production. The leading chip manufacturers have already demonstrated much smaller transistors, below 22 nanometer. So out of 6.8 million transistors, 4.4 million are devoted to L1 instruction and data caches. So you'll observe this trend more today actually. So percentage wise, how much is this? Roughly 2/3, right? Okay. So today actually it's even more. It's about 90% transistors devoted to caches. 10% goes to logic. So that's the today's rough division between memory and logic. It fetches, decodes, and renames 4 instructions every cycle. It has 64-bit registers, so the data path is 64-bit wide. It has on-chip 32 kilobyte L1 instruction and data caches, 2-way set alternative. Off-chip L2 cache of variable size, which you can reconfigure and put time by 12 kilobyte to 16 megabyte. 2-way pseudo set alternative. If you have forgotten this one, you can look up your past lecture notes. I'll also refresh your mind when we discuss this L2 cache. Line size 64 or 128 bytes. Again, reconfigurable at the boot time. So that's a summary of the processor. So what we'll do is we'll walk through each of the pipeline stages. Right. So in the fetch stage, the instructions are slightly pre-decoded, when the cache time is brought into instruction cache. So essentially what happens is that before you fill into instruction cache, each instruction is appended with four extra function unit bits. So essentially it says that to which function unit this instruction should go. So that simplifies your decode stage a little bit, because the decode stage would have to do this actually. Instead of that, before you put the instruction in instruction cache, you do this actually. It's a very simple thing to do, so that the subsequent accessors can reuse this particular instruction. You don't have to decode it over every time. Processor fetches four sequential instructions every cycle from the instruction cache. So remember that it has fetch, decode, read, and bandwidth of four instructions every cycle. Right? So you have to do this to be able to feed your pipeline properly. The instruction TLB has eight entries, fully associative, backed by a larger unified TLB. So there are two levels of TLB. The level one instruction TLB is small, but the second level TLB is much larger. There is no branch target buffer. So the fetcher really cannot do anything about branches other than fetching sequentially. So really do not know where you're going, so fetch sequentially until you have some better information. Fetched instructions are put in an 8-entry instruction buffer for the decoder to go through. So that's the fetch stage. Any question? Stage 2, decode rename. Decodes and renames four instructions every cycle. The targets of branches, unconditional jumps, and subroutine calls are computed in this stage. What this means is that you actually have an ALU in this particular stage to do this. Because targets of conditional branches will require an ALU because you have to add the offset to the PC plus 4. Right? For unconditional jumps, you need nothing. The decoder will give you the target because it's part of the instruction. Subroutine calls also will come directly from instruction, are computed in this particular stage. Okay, so these are all available here. Unconditional jumps are not fed into the pipeline, and the fetcher PC is modified directly by the decoder. So unconditional jumps do not make any further progress. Right here, the decoder tells the fetcher to fetch from the target program boundary. Okay. Conditional branches look up a bimodal predictor to predict the branch direction, taken or not taken, and accordingly modify the fetch PC. And the return instructions will look up a return address tag. So you have discussed all these gadgets, what they actually do. Okay. In fact, in your homework, you should be working on a bimodal predictor as well, and see how accurate that is. Any question on this? So this is the stage where actually fetcher gets the first information about what to do on a branch. Because remember that it doesn't have a BTP, so it was fetching sequentially. Okay, right? So a little bit on the branch prediction. These things we already know. The branches are predicted, and unconditional jumps are computed in stage 2. So there is always a one-cycle bubble, which is four instructions, which you cannot avoid. So remember that the branch delay slot, the legacy MIPS thing, continues here, okay, all right? But it's only just the one instruction after the branch. Okay. The remaining three are not in the branch list. Right? So essentially, you can think of it as one cycle bubble costing you three instructions, as opposed to four. Roughly, that's what it is. Provided, of course, the branch instruction was the last one in the previous packet, the four instructions. Okay. In case of branch misprediction, which will be detected later, the processor may need to roll back and restart fetching from the correct target. So how to do that? We have discussed this also in the class. You need to checkpoint the register map right after the branch is renamed, which will be needed to restore in case of misprediction. The processor supports at most four register map checkpoints. This is stored in a structure called a branch stack. It's really a FIFO actually. I don't know why they call it a stack. Okay. It's just a FIFO queue. So which means it can support only up to four in-flight branches, because every branch will require a checkpointed register map, and you have only space for four. The fifth branch will have to stop if the previous four branches haven't yet resolved. The predictor is an array of 512 2-bit saturated counters, so that's the bimodal predictor architecture, right? Can count up to three. So that's the definition of a saturated counter. You can count up to three. If already three, an increment does not have any effect, remains at three. Similarly, if the count is zero, a decrement does not have any effect, remains at zero. That's a 2-bit saturated counter. The array is indexed by these bits of the PC, bits 3 to 11. So it actually discards the lower three bits, 0, 1, and 2. Why is that? Any idea? We said that you should discard 2, right? The lower 2 bits, because the instructions are 4 byte length. But here they discard 3. Why is that? What is the next instruction on the branch? It's always executed, right? There's a delay slot. So can I think of the branch instruction to be actually used form of these two instructions? Right? Because I know that the next instruction on the branch will always be executed. And the restriction that Bips puts is that you cannot put a branch in the branch delay slot. So that means I can actually assume that my branch instructions effectively are 8 byte length. Right? Okay, so I can actually remove this lower 3 bits. So ignores lower 3 bits, takes the next 9 bits to index that 512 entry array. And the outcome is the count at the index of the predictor. If the count is at least 2, then predict taken, it is not taken. So that is a minor predictor. Simple algorithm, prediction accuracy of 85%+. That's what they showed for their benchmarks they used. Works fine for short pipes. So this also we discussed actually, that how this prediction accuracy actually has implication on the pipeline length. Okay, because we say that if you have a prediction accuracy of P and you allow n branches concurrently in flight, then I want this to be at least this to be bigger than 0.5. Okay. So actually, if you do this, in this case, n is 4, because we allow 4 branches, right? That's what we just said here. If you have 4 outstanding branches already, the fifth will stop. Okay, so n is 4, e is 0.85. So actually, you are fine. You can calculate that. You are actually above 0.5. 0.85 to the power of 4 is bigger than 0.5. The branch predictor is updated when a conditional branch retires. So in order update, because retirement is in order. At retirement, we know the correct outcome of the branch. At this point, the branch stack entry is also free. So we don't need that anymore. One branch stack entry contains the entire register map, not the register values, the target of the branch, and few control bits. So target has to be saved in the branch stack, because that may be needed to update the predictor, right, to know whether you need to correct or not. The decoder assigns a 4-bit branch mask to every instruction. Why is it needed? So in the pipeline, there can be at most 4 in-flight branches that we have already defined. I'm saying that each instruction goes out with a 4-bit branch mask. Can anybody guess what this is, first of all? What is this branch mask?
An array of 4 bits.
Yeah, and what is it holding it?
It's holding which one of those 4 positions does this branch belong to?
No, we're saying that you attach this mask to every instruction, not branches only. Can someone define a branch mask?
Dependency on the branches, the 4 branches. I mean, if that branch is taken, then this instruction is executed. So you have the bit for that.
Yeah, so essentially what you're saying is that if I have an instruction I, tell me which branches it is control dependent on. So that is this mask. Okay. So it may have all the bits set. Sorry?
It may be dependent on all of them.
Yes, right. So it may have all the bits set. So which means it has gone through 4 branches. So the fate of instruction I depends on the fate of all these branches. Right? So why is it needed actually? Why am I attaching this?
For misprediction.
How is it useful?
So if there's some misprediction, then we may have to re-execute squash out these the instructions that were wrongly dependent.
Right.
Dependent on the wrong.
How do I figure that out?
Which instruction? That particular bit.
Exactly. So what I do is whenever I mispredict a branch, let's say I mispredict the second branch, right? So I prepare a mask like this, 0100, and send this mask to the pipeline. So this mask will be ANDed with the masks of all the instructions. Okay. Only the non-zero outcomes will actually be kicked, right? Okay, because we know that those are the branch, those are the instructions that are control dependent on this particular branch. Okay. So it might be helpful if you are willing to, you are thinking of coming to the class, to brush up a little bit on renaming, all right, what the renaming does before you come to the class. That will help you understand the lectures. So we'll, after MIPS R10K, we'll take up a processor from Compaq Alpha and look at Pentium 4, two versions of Pentium 4, and a little bit on the core microarchitecture that is used in Core Duo and all that.